I think we're ready to get started. Thanks for joining today, everyone. Who is excited to be here? All right, a few of you. Who is jet lagged? Yeah, probably at least half the people here. Well, thank you for getting up. I suspect it was a pretty early morning for a bunch of you. Really appreciate it. We're pretty much exactly on time, which is fantastic. A few housekeeping notes before we get started with the keynotes for the day. First, I hope a lot of you would have seen my email about this, but with respect to the aisles and everything else in here, we can't have anybody blocking the aisles just for fire safety reasons. So that includes like cords, standing or sitting in the aisle. The ushers will ask you to move if you do that. So please let them be polite and Canadian and don't make them have to move you. The second is food and drinks. They're okay everywhere else outside of this theater, but the venue does ask that there be no food in the theater at any time and that drinks are only covered. So if you've got a covered coffee or whatever, that's fine, but you know, no open beverages. With respect to charging stations, that's largely in the conference area. So when you go out to where some of the breakout session rooms are, we've arranged some power strips and there are plugs throughout. So hopefully all of you will be able to find power. If you do have trouble, you can come talk to myself or Crystal or Tara, and maybe we could direct you to where you can find somewhere to plug in. For the evening cocktail hour, there are drink tickets. Those drink tickets will be handed out at lunch. So right where you did the registration, Crystal, Tara, myself will be there. Just come by, show us your pass, and we'll give you some drink tickets. A few final notes. If you haven't found the Wi-Fi already, this is also in the Slack channel, so it's a good reason to join the Slack channel. You'll get, this is the Wi-Fi network and the password. The one ask to speakers, a lot of you have already done this, but after, I know a lot of you are still working on your slides, so when your talks are done and your slides are ready, please do drop a link into the presentation schedule. All the speakers should have edit access to that document. If you don't have edit access, just email me and I'll get you sorted out. There are two rooms, 110 and 115, that are available all day for ad hoc collaboration and for recharging your devices. So please go ahead and just use those as you see fit. And finally, there will be useful information and opportunity to self-organize throughout the conference in the Slack channel. So please do go ahead and join that. It will probably be helpful for coordinating things throughout the event. There are a couple of changes that I want to share. Unfortunately, Hong Zhang was not able to join. So that is in session three today, improved browser profiling for real life web pages. If you are interested in that topic, he is keen to collaborate. So please find him on the Slack channel, and his slides are also posted in the presentation schedule. There's also an announcement from the Chrome operations team. This delegation builds, maintains CRBug, Goma, Garrett, basically, if you are, if you have any ideas for how to improve Chromium developer experience, or you have questions or frustrations, you can go by and see them in room 105 during any of the breaks today. So that's room 105 during the breaks. We'll add that in the Slack room as well, just so that it's easy for you to remember. Speaking of where the rooms are, this is the diagram here. I've also dropped this in Slack, so you should be able to track it down fairly easily. As you can see, we're kind of cut off over there. This is part of the main stage is visible. There's the atrium areas, and then the whole conference center is through the double doors, which is just kind of up a short set of stairs outside right next to where you first came into the building. Should be easy to find, but if you do find yourself not remembering where rooms are, this diagram is in Slack. So I heard that people like data, so I thought, well, why not? Let's do a little bit of, pull up a little bit of data. So you can see here that we have quite a number of different companies represented in the conference today. Delighted to kind of be bringing together the best open source browsers to one spot. And I was running some numbers in terms of what the growth of this conference was, and saw that between BlinkOn 8, BlinkOn 9, we were about 25% growth, and then up to BlinkOn 10, about the same. And, you know, using a proprietary algorithm, I decided to, you know, figure out what would happen by Blink on 30. We're going to have to make some accommodation. I did add some probability, some error in there. So, if, you know, we're plus or minus a couple thousand on the candlesticks. So by 74, we'll have everyone on planet Earth developing for Chromium, which is pretty exciting, actually. And it does mean that we're going to have to make some future plans with respect to Blink on 11. So we'll be sharing those with you tomorrow. That's it for housekeeping. I'd like to invite Ben Galbraith now up to the stage. He's the Director of Product Management for the web platform.
It's great to be here this morning. Thank you to everyone for making the trip out here. Before we get too far into what I have to say, I wanted to thank Peter and also other folks who have been involved in organizing BlinkCon. This is Tara, Crystal, Benji, and so many others. Can we give a round of applause to those who have participated in organizing? This really is a huge job behind the scenes, and I really appreciate all the effort that's gone into it. So this morning, I just wanted to share a few thoughts about, at Google, how we're thinking about Chromium and our vision for our contributions in Chromium towards the future of the web. And it was really about 10 years ago that the Chromium project was born with the goal of influencing what at the time were the popular browsers of the age. And there is a little bit of a hope that maybe some folks would use Chromium directly in the form of Chrome, but it was really about influencing the ecosystem. And now billions of people use Chromium-based browsers, which is really cool. And it's so exciting, as Peter was just saying, to have so many representatives from these teams and many others here today. We wanted to give a special shout out to one of the newest members of the community, Microsoft, who just yesterday released their first Chromium builds to the public. Let's give a round of applause to welcome Microsoft. One of those moments going back 10, 15 years, who would have predicted this turn of events? It's fantastic that we're all here working together on the future of the web platform. And as we're looking past, it's been 30 years this year since the web was born, which is kind of an amazing moment that makes me feel my lack of gray hair, I think. But it started with this simple vision that Tim Berners-Lee articulated here. Suppose all the information stored on computers were linked, and suppose I could program my computer to create a space in which everything could be linked to everything. And this, of course, builds on earlier visions going back decades, including this one from Vannevar Bush talking about the memics, which I'm sure you've all read about at some point. But by the way, how cool is it that you can link to the sort of canonical representation of this article on the web, which is the best implementation of his vision back in the day? Tim also talked about the importance of the web moving forward. And I wanted to start my remarks just sort of reflecting on this with you. I love this quote, "The fight for the web is one of the most important causes of our time." Is this hyperbolic? Why is this? When you think about it, our perspective is that the openness of the web has at least three major properties that are worthy of our time and investment. One of which is the maximization of innovation that happens with open platforms. We see this time and time again in technology that open ecosystems allow innovation unfettered in a way that closed ecosystems tend to reduce over time. The economic opportunity that's created through openness is fantastic. It allows consumers to connect to anyone and any participant in the ecosystem and prevents the gatekeeping that constrains economic opportunity as winners emerge. And freedom of expression, without the control and repression that can otherwise occur. These are fantastic attributes of open ecosystems generally and of the open web and are at the foundation of why this is such an important effort that we're all involved with. It's not perfect, and this year, as you may have noticed, Tim Berners-Lee and others have talked about the importance of how the web needs to change. And there's a big effort going on to influence governments and businesses and also a grassroots campaign to influence the actions of developers and citizens. Google's a supporter of this. These are all great efforts. But in the proudest tradition of the Chromium project, we're really here over the next few days to talk about how the code we write can make the web better, can strengthen the web, and in turn strengthen the world that we're in. And this also reflects the fact that ultimately, the web has influence only if users choose to use the web. And users generally make these decisions not based on these sort of high-minded principles, but really more simple concepts, like whether or not the platform is competitive in terms of the novelty that it offers you, and more fundamentally, the utility that it provides as you just try to get things done. And so, as we've thought about what our vision is for the future of the web, we really think about this simple mission of making the web platform the premier way that users can experience information. By experience, we mean discover, consume, engage with, interact with, transact with information, and through Chromium, delivering the world's best implementation of the web platform, a mission that we think all of us together in this room can collaborate on. To be more specific, we've organized our efforts in three ways. First, the core experience of browsing the web. Second, building powerful applications on top of that core experience. And third, helping developers achieve success. And for the next few minutes, I just want to talk about concretely the outcomes that we want to achieve in these areas over the next several years. Let's start with web content. For us, it's really simple. We imagine a web where the majority of sites that a user visits load instantly, and once loaded, work consistently offline and provide a seamless interaction and transact easily. And we have a bunch of projects along this area, and after I'm done, we'll have Annie come up and talk about these in more detail. But the animation you see here talks about one of them that I'm particularly excited about. It's this effort called Portals, and what you see here in this animation is a seamless transition that happens because there's an iframe-like construct that preloads content, and once the user taps on a link, it can actually transition to become the top-level origin. And this depends on another emerging standard, web packaging, which enables privacy-preserving preloading of the content. And this is the first phase of web packaging, which we'll talk more about. When it's finished, it also provides a model for how offline can be a much simpler thing for developers to achieve, and how content can be distributed in a decentralized way. When we talk about seamlessly, what we mean here is enabling an outcome where the frame rate refresh as well as interaction all happens with incredibly low latency and predictable outcomes. And when we talk about simple transactions, we're really striving for an outcome where things like authentication and payments, any data exchange, all happens with the essential friction, very, very minimal friction. And we see this as providing the foundation for assistive computing, which is something that we believe over the next few years has the potential to become mainstream. And by enabling the browser to broker transactions, we lay the foundation for the web integrating with assistive computing at some point. So this is our vision for web content. Building on this, we want the web to be perceived as a first-class app platform. You may have seen in November of last year, we announced this thing called Project Fugu, which is an increased investment that we're making at Google to add missing capabilities to the web platform. The screenshot here shows AutoCAD coming to the web. We see this as the first of a new wave of uncompromised desktop-grade applications that can come to the web platform and provide a powerful experience that's deeply integrated with the user's workflow. And our vision is an outcome where mainstream users view the web as the place where they can get everything they need done. We have a gap today, and we want to close that over time. Third area is developer success. Ultimately, all of our efforts to improve the core experience of the web and to increase the power of the web platform can't succeed if developers don't partner with us in driving their investments on the web platform. And we think they'll do that if the web offers the best value to developers, which we think is all about giving them the best return on investment, the lowest cost to develop for the highest access to users, the access to the largest body of users. And you've seen a couple of investments that we've made over the past few months in this direction. We just refreshed our approach to engaging with the web developer ecosystem with something called web.dev, which reflects this vision where developers can go to a simple place that helps them understand exactly how they can achieve great results with the platform. You may have noticed also last year we announced this framework sponsorship fund, which is part of a bunch of efforts we've been taking to work really closely with the JavaScript framework ecosystem so that as developers use popular web frameworks, they can expect to get a great web experience by default, which today is too often not the case. Now, these efforts in web content, web apps, and developer success are built on the foundations of trust and safety and fundamental excellence. And our vision here on trust and safety is to continually earn users' trust in the platform. We can't get where we need to go if users don't feel like the web is safe in every definition of what they expect from that. We've made a lot of investments here in the past with projects like safe browsing, more TLS, and process isolation, which we talked about late last year. At Google I.O. this year, expect to hear us talk more about the investments we'll be making in this area throughout 2019 and beyond. And we're making a major effort to increase the efficiency of Chromium, both to support the emerging device ecosystem, where the web has to run on amazingly constrained low-end devices, but also to build users' confidence that in using web apps on top of the platform, they'll have an efficient experience that they feel good about. Okay, so over the next few days, we'd love your feedback here at BlinkOn on this vision, on where at Google we want to see the web go and where we're making our investments in the Chromium project. We'd love to learn about your vision for the web and how we can adapt our vision and collaborate more closely together. And now, I'd like to introduce Annie Sullivan, who will provide more details on these themes and go into greater depth on the projects we're working on. Annie's been with Chromium since the beginning. It's kind of also considered a bit of a native. You're from the US, from the Michigan area, but we like to think she's part of the sort of Waterloo, Toronto area. Anyway, let's give Annie a warm welcome. Thank you, Annie.
Hey, everybody. Okay, sorry, I haven't used a clicker before. All right, I wanted to talk more about what we're doing in Blink. I wanted to start with the fundamentals that Ben just spoke about, everything we need to make a solid web platform. So performance, memory usage, security and privacy, we need good code health, and we need great bug triage. We've had a lot of really awesome accomplishments since the last BlinkOn. First, we're shipping the unified heap. This is so exciting. It reduces memory and it improves security, it makes performance better, and it simplifies the code and cleans it up at the same time, unifying the Blink and V8 garbage collection. So I'm so excited for this launch. We've improved memory usage dramatically, especially on low-end Android, where even a few megabytes of RAM can cause huge performance and stability issues for users. So I'm really, really excited to see these improvements going in. One thing to notice is that all of these are actually years of, like almost a year or more than a year of engineering effort and to get this much improvement, but you could actually regress this much in a single CL. So please, when you get a heap profiler bug or you get a perfbot memory bug, please take a look at those because that can save a ton of memory as well and keep these gains for our users. Over the summer, we shipped site isolation on desktop. Site isolation limits the renderer process to a single origin, and this protects our users against attack vectors like Spectre. It was a huge amount of work under the covers, years of refactoring, so it's really exciting to see it launch. And we have lots more in progress for the future. Layout NG redesigns the layout engine from the ground up, really thinking about modern web content and what we've learned over many years. BlinkGem property trees simplifies the graphical compositing data structures in preparation for making compositing decisions after paint. Cooperative scheduling allows for performance isolation so that we can more easily yield JavaScript running in iframes and other important ways of making sure that what the user is looking at gets priority. But one area that we really need to improve on is bug triage. We have some teams that are really doing great and keeping their components triaged, but other areas not so much, and you can see the SLO violations are up and to the right. So we'll be reaching out to teams about making sure the components are triaged and also working on getting standardized priorities across the web platform. We've also made a lot of progress on code health, which is super important for everybody to be able to move forward. There's been a 50% increase in the number of markdown files, so that's documentation files, in the Blink code base just since the last BlinkOn. Mojovication and Onion Soup continue to make great progress, and we completely removed a third-party WebKit from the code base. There's a lot more work being done in Code Health. We'd like to get a bit more organized. So there's a Slack channel on the Chromium. It's on the Chromium Slack. It's called TechDebt, if you want to join the conversation. There's also a proposal out about possibly doing a rotation for Code Health, similar to how we do sheriffing rotations. So if you have feedback in that, it's in the slides. Please go ahead and give feedback. Next, I want to talk about web content. As Ben said, native users have come to expect really seamless transitions between views. We want to make loading instant, and we want to make transitions completely seamless. So one of the things we've done since last Blinkdown is shipped signed exchanges. As Ben says, these are privacy-preserving prefetches. So an aggregator site can preload content from a third-party site, and then we can have a near-instant transition to that content without the original aggregator kind of invading the user's privacy about how they're using the third-party site. We also had lots and lots of individual speed improvements since last BlinkCon. We've been working hard on the slowest sites on the slowest connections. We've made tons of improvements to V8 and lots of other code improvements. And I wanted to give a visual of how this works. Let me see if I can get the slides to go. I have a really cool video that I can't get to play. Okay, well, if I can make it work, what it would show is on the right, it would show a really fast page load and then slower and slower and slower as you go back to Chrome. You can see this page loads in 3 seconds in M75. And going back all the way to M48, it took 7.6 seconds to load. So we're doubling our load speed. We're making dramatic improvements for users. But the thing that's a little bit difficult about this, here is a graph between the first two versions on the left of what we're seeing in the real world. So end users on real websites on Android. These are various page load metrics at the 90th percentile. And it looks like maybe they're going down a bit. And then they go up and down, but they're not really going down as dramatically as they do in the video where we're like dropping by 50%. And it almost seems as if web content gets slower as fast as we can improve Chrome. And so we've been really worried about this problem and trying to think a lot about what to do about it. And one thing that we've really tried to do since the last BlinkCon especially is have that same focus that we have on performance metrics in the web platform, where we try to think about page load and input delay, for example, as like really having a big focus. And we tried to do that same thing for developers. We made sure that Lighthouse and DevTools had all the metrics that we have. We launched the Chrome User Experience Report, which among other things will show you page load metrics for all websites above a certain volume. So you can see what real users are experiencing on your site and on your competitor's site. And Google Search also announced and launched a ranking change on Android where they take speed into account. And all of these things together, you can't see one single drop in the graph like you do with a regular performance improvement, but you can see like the time to load a page just tumbling down over time. With all of these things combined, the efforts that we're making directly to improve the web platform and then our developer outreach combine really lock in the changes and make things faster for users. But we're not even close to done yet. So as Ben said, the Portals project is going to make seamless transition from iframe to main content and really improve our story around seamless transitions. We have a lot of work planned to also improve page loads and transitions back for cache on Android. Lots and lots coming. So really excited for that. Next, I want to talk about web applications. It's really important to be able to support rich web apps in the web platform. We want it to be on par with native as a application development platform. And one of the biggest things that we need to address is the gap in capabilities with native. Here's a chart of intents to implement since last BlinkCon. A year before last BlinkCon. So you can see we're just continuing to narrow that capabilities gap at a very high velocity over the past 2 years. The bottom green line is origin trials. So origin trials aren't appropriate for everything, but they're really great when we need to get developer feedback of real web developers working on real websites and understanding how our APIs are used for their use cases. We can do this before we finalize an API and launch it to the world and have to support it together. So it's forever. So it's really exciting to see usage of origin trials increasing. And here is a partial list of new features that we've shipped just since last BlinkOn to narrow that capability gap. We're not just working on capabilities, though. We're also working on making the developer experience better for the base that they need to build on. Service Worker is our technical base for offline and push notifications and basically like making a web app a real app. And so we've been working really hard on quality improvements to Service Worker. We've made a lot of performance improvements and API improvements to make it easier for developers to use and easier for users to interact with. And since last BlinkOn, we also shipped desktop PWAs on all platforms, which is really exciting. Progressive web apps allow a native-like experience driven by the web. So now we can have that not just on mobile, but on any operating system. Again, there's lots and lots going on in the future. Project Fugu is behind a lot of these new APIs, and I'm sure lots of this will be talked about in upcoming talks at BlinkOn. The last thing that we have to focus on is developer success. Ben already talked a lot about how we've launched web.dev and we've made DevTools improvements and our developer relations teams are working really hard to help developers succeed. But there's also a lot that we need to do on the web platform to make this happen. Since last BlinkOn, we shipped an origin trial of the very first built-in module. This is an idea we're experimenting with to have JavaScript modules built right into the browser so that every page doesn't have to increase the size of the bundle. And we're getting feedback on it right now. We've shipped user activation v2. So about 30 Chrome APIs depend on user activation. And our old model for user activation was really complex to the point where other vendors couldn't implement it. So user activation v2 simplifies the model quite a bit so that if we have APIs that depend on user activation, then other browsers can implement that the same way. That's really important for interop, which is a very top issue for developers. We ship the reporting API and the reporting observer. Those allow developers to specify an endpoint and a set of errors and warnings that they want to hear about at that endpoint, so we can let them know about all sorts of problems on their site. We've also shipped the first feature policy. Feature policies help web developers adopt best practices. They can specify the feature policy for their site and any included iframes. So this feature policy allows them to say they're not going to use synchronous XHRs, and then Chrome would block that usage. And this is a really important performance anti-pattern for the web. So it's really cool to see the first feature policy ship. And the violation reporting in origin trials, so that will go back to the reporting observer. In the future, we're going to ship a lot more feature policies to help developers adopt best practices. IDL compiler v2 is in the works, and that will help us with interop. And we're also working on HTML modules. So interoperability, again, it's just a top developer complaint about the web. And we've been working really hard on web platform tests to improve interoperability across browsers. So this is a chart of the passing tests since the last BlinkOn, and you can see it's going really in the right direction. More tests and more tests passing on all browsers. And 45% or 49% of source test changes have web platform tests. They use web platform test, and that's an all-time high. So we're really happy about that, but we'd like to get it up to 90%, so please keep that in mind as you're coding. The web platform test team has also added two new features to help drive down failures. First, you can query by browser, so you can find failures that only happen in Chrome. And you can also see screenshots of failing ref tests, so everybody can help drive down interop failures in Chrome. And that's all I had. Thanks, everybody, for contributing so much. I'm really excited about all of these changes, and I can't wait to see what we do next. And I'm really happy to introduce Laszlo from Samsung to talk about Samsung's vision for the web platform.
Hello, good morning. My name is Laszlo Gombos. I'm very excited to be here at BlinkOn and share with you Samsung's vision about the web platform. So Samsung is very well known. It's a consumer electronics product portfolio. But did you know that most of the connected devices from Samsung comes with Samsung Internet web browser pre-installed? Not only TVs and Galaxy mobile devices, but even refrigerators and the Galaxy Watch includes Samsung Internet as well. Our vision, Samsung's vision, is that web is the open platform that connects Samsung devices and creates this rich multi-device experiences between all these products. Samsung has been building web browsers since 2008. That's 11 years now and counting. The company is committed to invest in the web platform for the long run. We not only committed to the web platform, but specifically to the Chromium open source project, as all of our browsers and all of our products are aligned to be based on Chromium and Blink. We understand the importance of regular browser updates. Samsung Internet is now committed to 6-yearly releases with security updates on all Android devices. Our stable channel Android just passed 1 billion downloads. Our contribution to Chromium shows our commitment as well. We have over 200 different engineers from Samsung, more than 7,000 contributions over the past years to the Chromium open source code base. Our experience with the contribution shows that Chromium is a really welcoming community. So I thank you all for that. These are just a few examples of areas of contribution and focus that Samsung has been involved with. I don't really have time to go through all of them. But it's not just about Chromium. We are actively participating in the larger web ecosystem as well. As an example, we active members of the web payment and the WebXR working group and the tag as well. Last year, we ran our first web community event. We invited experts from Mozilla, Microsoft, and Google. Please take this opportunity to say hi and chat with our engineers in person. And lastly, I would like to thank two of my colleagues, Hijin and Dan Applequist, to help me out with these slides. Thank you for your attention, and I would like to invite to the stage Jitender to talk about the experiences that Microsoft has.
Thanks, Laszlo. My name is Jitender Mann, and I'm a group program manager for the Microsoft Edge web platform team. Last December, we announced that the next major version of Microsoft Edge will be built off of the Chromium open source project, and that will help improve web compatibility for our customers and create less fragmentation of the web for web developers. Yesterday, we made available our first Canary and Dev Channel builds of Microsoft Edge built on the Chromium project. So it is not only our intention to adopt Chromium, but we want to grow and become significant contributors to this project in a way that will not only make Microsoft Edge better, but make all other browsers built on Chromium better as well. We recognize that making the web better on Windows is good for our business, our customers, and our partners. So I wanted to start by saying thank you. Thank you to the Chromium community, to the Google engineers that have really welcomed us into this project. You can imagine when we joined this project, we were a bit nervous, but we've had a great experience so far and are looking forward to working together with everyone to help build a better web platform. When we joined this project, we shared our intentions to embrace and engage in the Chromium community in a way that embraces existing models that have worked with Chrome for a very long time in the Chromium project. This includes making meaningful and positive contributions, which align with longstanding, thoughtfully designed architecture, helping build a collaborative engineering culture, and seeking the best outcome for all people, no matter what device they use. As we participate in the Chromium project, we look forward to holding ourselves accountable to these principles. The first is, we're in it for the long term. We expect our engineers to learn and over time become Chromium experts and become active members of the community, including maintaining any contributions we make. Number two, when it comes to the web platform, our default position is to contribute. So while we will continue to compete and focus on building a world-class browser with differentiated user experiences and connected services through Microsoft Edge, when it comes to the platform, we're seeking a rising tide floats all boats approach. Number three, we will respect and adhere to the architectural requirements of the Chromium project. So while we are offering our Windows platform expertise, we are going to help improve all Chromium-based browsers on Windows. We're going to contribute in a way that's consistent with the architectural designs and needs of the Chromium project's cross-platform and cross-device users. And finally, while we will implement our platform features in Chromium, we still believe that the evolution of the open web is best served through standards discussions. And the open web benefits from a wide variety of perspectives and debate. So we will remain deeply and vigorously engaged in standards discussions, whether that's at the W3C, What Working Group, IETF, or other standards bodies, where the perspectives of many different browser vendors and the community at large can be heard and considered. So while we've only been in this journey for a couple months, we've already made some modest but meaningful contributions, including Microsoft landing almost 300 commits into the Chromium project since our December announcement. These are some of the areas of focus that we will focus on making contributions in the coming year, including a number of areas where we've already started to make some changes. This includes our commitment to helping build a more accessible web platform for everyone. So we're working with the Google Accessibility team to help add support for accessibility tools like screen readers and settings like high contrast, caret browsing, and caption styling. We're happy to see our ARM64 changes land, which will enable any Chromium-based browser to support ARM devices. We're happy to see Windows Hello support land as well to support better passwordless and two-factor auth scenarios. We're also starting to reach out to Chromium experts and look forward to partnering together on battery life, editing, fonts, layout, scrolling, security, and other scenarios like DevTools. On the touch front, we're happy to see our TSF1 changes land last month, which will enable a Chromium-based browser to better support Windows Touch Keyboard, including auto text suggestion and shape writing. And finally, when it comes to web standards, we will also contribute new web platform APIs that help solve our customers' unmet needs. We have a couple sessions at BlinkOn today. Later this afternoon, Christian will talk through our journey building a brand new browser based off of Chromium and some of our learning experiences. Tomorrow, we will go through our investments around accessibility and talk about a new tool that we're open sourcing that helps with post-mortem debugging. So I wanted to end by saying thank you. Thank you for having us here today and welcoming us into this community. And we really look forward to working with everyone to build a better web for all. Thanks.
So big thank you to all of our speakers. We are a little bit ahead of schedule, so we are now on coffee break, and we'll reconvene at 11 o'clock for the first session. See you soon.